Good morning and welcome to Highlands United Methodist Church virtual service of worship for Sunday, July the 19th. We've just entered into the 10 o'clock hour, and if you're joining us here live during this time, we'd invite you to let us know if you have prayer requests. A little later on this morning, Christine Murphy will be offering a prayer, and if you have a name that you would like to add to that prayer list this morning, just simply put it in the comment section there on Facebook. Again, if you are watching us in the 10 o'clock hour on this Sunday, July the 19th. I'm Randy Lucas. I'm the pastor of the church, and I'm delighted to be joined here this morning in this physical space with Christine Murphy, our director of children and youth ministries, her husband Mike Murphy, who is our producer once again today. We have our musicians today. We have Sherry Bruner at the piano. We'll say a word about that in just a moment. We also have Les Scott, our minister of music, and we're delighted to welcome today Carol Shuttleworth and also Paula Gordon, who will be part of our musical ensemble. I would remind you that as we worship today, we are always looking to have you participate as much as possible. A little later on, we'll look at our joys, and we'll look at some pictures that folks have sent in, and we always encourage you to send pictures or selfie videos of joys that we might be able to use in our time of virtual worship. Well, for those of you who might have been with us yesterday, you know that we had our first ever virtual memorial service as we remembered and celebrated the life of Wiley Sloan. We also debuted a gift to the congregation yesterday, a beautiful Baldwin grand piano that has been donated by one of our church members, Patty Campbell. Patty played at that service yesterday. Today, Sherry Bruner will be playing. This will be the first time we've been able to use that grand piano in our virtual worship, and so we'll look forward to hearing from Sherry a little later on this morning, and we will have an appropriate dedication of the grand piano at another time. With that, again, this word of welcome, we are thrilled to have you with us as we worship today. We invite Jacob Lancaster, one of our Duke Summer Ministry interns, to lead us in our morning prayer.
Good morning, Highlands UMC. This morning, I am standing on my front porch right next to my front door in my house. And I'm standing here because I like to think about how special a front door is. This is the place where we can bring people in. This is the place where I invite my friends, my family, to share in the fellowship within the house, to eat together, to talk together, to share in each other's presence. And I'm standing here because I think about how God is also inviting us into His house. Jesus talks about how His Father's house has many rooms. There are many places for us to stay. But we have to step off the porch. We have to step inside the house and really embrace this loving hospitality that God is offering us. So this morning, I pray that we can open ourselves and step through the door. Please pray with me. Lord, thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for this opportunity to gather together and worship. I pray that you give us courage to step inside. Let's not linger on the porch, O God. Help us to really embrace fully this love, this opportunity of fellowship with you. Open our eyes to see your love. Open our hearts to feel your grace. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus. And now please join us as the band sings When the Saints Go Marching In.
Our first reading this morning is from Romans chapter 8, verse 12 through 25. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now, and not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we are saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. The word of God. For the people of God. Thanks be to God. And now let us say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now as we come to our time of prayer in our service, let us take a few moments with the band to center our hearts and our minds. Thank you. Let us pray. Merciful God, you plant each of us like seeds in the same field, and together we are nourished and nurtured by the sun. We sway in the wind are refreshed by the rain. We are blessed by the knowledge that you want us to grow towards what you call us to be. When we deprive others of that same opportunity, forgive us. When we want to uproot those whom we believe do not belong in our part of the field, forgive us. When we label others as good or bad rather than accept them for who they are, forgive us. When we are reluctant to acknowledge that we ourselves are a mixture of weeds and wheat, forgive us. When we are afraid to look into the fields of our own lives to see what is growing there, forgive us. O God, you know us inside and out, through and through. You search us out and lay your hand upon us. You know what we are going to say even before we speak. So we pray that you will help us to reach out to the uprooted and rejected, the lonely and the outcast, and to develop and grow the good in ourselves, in others, and throughout the world. Today we come before you in prayer, and we especially name Christopher, Kelly, Jeff, Zane, Janice, Lacey, Barbara, Lindsay, Holly, Hal, Lisa, Kayla, Will, Renta, Peter, Tracy, Thomas, Ray and Wanda, Amanda, Beth, Julia, Jill, Megan, Carol, Deb, Connor, the families of Tyrone and Shapiro, Leah, Sam, Genevieve, Patty, Sherry, Randy, Brenda, Hannah, all those still unemployed, and travel mercies for those traveling, and peace. Dear God, you know all these needs better than we do. We lift them up to you today, along with those still unnamed in our hearts. Be with each of them, hear their prayers. Hold each of them tight in your arms today and throughout the coming week. And now we come together to pray the prayer Jesus taught us all to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We enter into our time of service now of celebrating joys. And again, we encourage you, if you have a selfie video or a picture with a bit of a description that you could share with us, for us to enjoy together and celebrate in our time of worship. We are always thrilled to do that. And I would remind you, again, after our worship service formally closes during this virtual hour, we will have a brief coffee hour virtually, again, just for a few moments. We wave and say hello and get to see everyone for just a few moments. So we would encourage you to do that. Mike will provide for you a link for that Zoom meeting in the comment section, so just be on the lookout for that. We also want to celebrate anniversaries and birthdays. As we think about our joys, we are, and I see that Mike and Christine have a birthday tomorrow, along with Tony and Terry Potts, so an early happy birthday, and Les and Deborah Scott coming up in a couple of days, along with Paul and Britt Einacone, so happy anniversary to those happy couples. We also have several birthdays. I won't name those, but just invite you to look at that list, and happy birthday to all the folks who are going to be celebrating a birthday in these coming days, beginning today. We have birthdays listed today, and so we celebrate those birthdays and anniversaries today. We also want to lift up some of the beautiful pictures that you've shared with us. Don Germano just sent us this picture of a swan. I'm not sure the context of this, but it's just a lovely picture, and we are grateful for that. Don, thank you for sharing that picture with us today. We also have a beautiful daylily made by the hand of our Creator, Remsen Solomon. put that note in there, and it is a beautiful day, Lily. Thank you for sharing that with us in our joys today, Remsen. We also have another beautiful flower. Greg Clarkson sent this beautiful picture of God's blessings as we could celebrate our joys today. So we are grateful for that, Greg. Thank you so much. And we are happy to celebrate that Dave Cashin has been named the Teacher of the Year for Highland School. It's a great picture of Dave there. That's just that is Dave Cashin up one side and down the other. But a great teacher, and we want to celebrate. He has been named the 2019-2020 Teacher of the Year for Highland School. So we are grateful, and we celebrate that. Grateful for his good work with the students, grateful for his life and ministry, and we celebrate that good news with Dave. And now we enter into that time in our service that we've been engaging in during the month of July. Angie Hoon, one of our Duke Summer Ministry interns, has been providing for us a couple of reflections around contagious generosity during July, and we are happy to have that segment now.
So if this radical and contagious generosity is an attribute of God, and we know that it is because it's a fruit of the Spirit, then how can we not learn to give more radically and contagiously and extravagantly to the work of the kingdom of God? If it is at the heart of the center of God, then we want to be shaped that way. We want to become more Christ-like and learn to live that way. And in doing so, we become more like Christ here on earth, helping all those around us, whether it's sharing our knowledge, our wisdom, our time, our presence, or just sharing resources. It is Christ-like, and it is good. And so, if that's our mission, to be more in unity with one another and to help others and to serve our neighbors as if they were ourselves, how can we not get out of the way and allow God to show up in a radical way by giving more of ourselves than maybe we think we are even capable of giving? It's something to reflect on, and it is a reflection of generosity. Now close with this little prayer for generosity, and this week comes from Saint Ignatius of Loyola. Lord, teach me to be generous. Teach me to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not ask for reward, save that of knowing that I am doing your will. Amen. Have a blessed week, a blessed week of contagious generosity. Share the good news.
Thank you, Angie. And you know, as I was thinking, as Angie was sharing, she reminds me so much of Bishop Robert Shenazy's book, The Five Practices of Fruitful Congregations. One of those five practices is extravagant generosity. And one of the things that Bishop Shenazy talks about is obviously encouraging the tithe as a spiritual practice, but recognizing that for a lot of folks, if you don't tithe, going from 0 to 10% can be a little daunting. So he encourages proportional giving with the goal of tithing. Maybe start off with 3%, next year 5%, and you get the idea. And Kathy and I have been tithing for a number of years, and it is a spiritual practice, and we see that as an act of worship. We've really experienced the proportional piece of giving and generosity really over the last 3 years since we started our Finishing the Race campaign to pay off this beautiful Faith and Fellowship Center in 3 years. Our goal is to get it completely paid off by June 30th of 2021. And Jerry Moore was with us a couple of weeks ago. Jerry had come up with this idea of giving, encouraging people to give every week back when we started this 2 years ago now. And a number of people have done that, and we took on that challenge. Kathy and I took on that challenge. We felt like we could maybe be comfortable with $50 a week, committing to that on top of our tithe. And so we did that for the first year. And the second year, we thought, okay, well, 50 was okay. Let's try to add 25 to that. So in the second year, we gave $75 a week in addition to our tithing. And this year, the third and hopefully final year, we'll hopefully be able to bring it home on this final leg of the race. We have made a commitment to give $100 a week in addition to our normal tithing. And I tell you that just as a way of, it's been really interesting for me and for us to experience that. If we would have started off at $100 a week, we would have really felt that would have been a burden for us financially, and we wouldn't have felt that we could do that. We couldn't have found a way to do that. But it's interesting how incrementally when you give and adding just a little more to it really makes it much easier and really is a blessing. Spiritually speaking, giving is always about our relationship with God and our desire to give back what God has so freely given to us. So thank you. Let me say that as we have started year three of our finishing the race, and Jerry put in some more jelly beans a couple of weeks ago. Thank you for your continued support of our efforts to finish the race and to pay off this beautiful Faith and Fellowship Center. And thank you for your continued faithful giving to Highlands United Methodist Church. Giving is a spiritual matter. It's not about the church bills or the church budget. Obviously, there are church bills and there is a church budget, and when you give and you support this congregation, it is a blessing and enables us to do the work that we feel like we are called to do. And this has been a challenging time for churches across the land because of everything that has gone on with the coronavirus. So thank you. We've been blessed that people have continued to be very generous, our HUMC family, so thank you for that. Another way we can support the life and ministry of the church is through our shopping online through Amazon. If you purchase your items through Amazon, through the Amazon Smile option, and if you identify HUMC as your charitable focus, then you see part of your proceeds will go to support HUMC. So that's really an easy way to support the life and ministry of the church. We're going to enter into our virtual time of offering now. There are a number of ways that you can give and support the work of the church. Many of you have dropped checks by the little black mailbox sitting on the porch where the rocking chairs are on Main Street, or dropped them in the mail to us. Many of you have given online virtually, and that's really an easy thing to do. It's really just a couple of steps, and it's actually kind of fun to do. So I'm going to step over here in just a moment, and I am going to do my virtual offering. In this moment, if you are an online giver, we would invite you to engage in that virtual offering right now as Sherry plays for us. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the bounty of your blessings. We thank you for your extravagant generosity that you have poured out upon us in so many ways. We thank you for the opportunity we have to support your work in the world through the life of the church. Grateful that we can give back a portion of what belongs to you for the upbuilding of your kingdom here on earth. So we pray your blessings upon the gifts that have been given in the variety of ways that they are offered to the life and ministry of the church. And we pray that you would help us as your church to be good stewards of that which belongs to you that you entrust to our care for a season. We pray your blessings. In your holy name we pray. Amen. We'll look now to our music ensemble to lead us in a special music. We'll understand it better by and by.
When I was at Trinity United Methodist Church, that would be two churches ago, I met an African-American woman. Her name was Bee, and I can't for the life of me remember her last name. But she and I were working up this song to use in worship, and I played it for her the way that I heard it. And she sort of looked at me and she said, "Honey, you played that real pretty right out of the book, but this is the way it goes. We are tossed and driven on the restless sea of time. Somber skies and howling tempests oft succeed a bright sunshine in the land of perfect day. When the mists have rolled away, we will understand it better by and by. Thirsty hills and barren lands, we are trusting in the Lord, and according to God's word, we will understand it better by and by. Would lead us in that blessed promised land, but he guides us with his eye. He'll follow till we die, for we'll understand it better by and by.
By and by.
reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, verses 24 through 30 and 36 through 43. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. While everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in the field? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, An enemy has done this. The slave said to him, Then do you want us to go and gather them? But he replied, No. For in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time I will tell the reapers, Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. And on to verse 36. Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples approached him, saying, Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. He answered, The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the word, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers. And they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks so much, Jacob. Let me say a word of thanks to our musical ensemble today. Les and Sherry and Carol and Paula. What a beautiful rendition. I don't think I've ever heard it quite that lively or lovely, so thank you for that. That was lovely. We had just a moment of scramble. My batteries died on my headset just before Jacob finished, so luckily Christine was close by with a microphone, so Christine, thank you for that. And in fact, I'm going to step out of, since I had my coffee cup. Can I hand this to you, please? Yeah. Feel awkward with having two things in my hand all of a sudden, but thank you for that. So we have another parable of seeds and seed sowing, right? We had the parable of the sower last week. Those of you who were with us last week may remember that. We thought about the different soils that received the seed. This week, the focus really is on the seed and also the one who sows the seed. You have the good seed that's sown, and then you have the bad seed that is sown. And so there is a diabolical intent in this evening or nightfall seed sowing by the evil one. So as we think about this scripture this morning, one of the things that's always stepped out or jumped out at me when I've read this text in previous years is the recognition of what is our work to do and what is not our work to do. I'm fascinated, if you heard Jacob read the text, when the landowner is confronted by the fact that weeds are coming up with the wheat, and the workers say, do you want us to go and start pulling up the weeds? The landowner says, no, because you would pull up the wheat as well. You would uproot the wheat. He didn't say you might uproot the wheat. He said you would uproot the wheat. In other words, I hear that in the parable, and this is unique to Matthew. There's no other gospel that has this particular parable, so this is the only place we have this. It seems quite evident in the flow of the narrative in the gospel that the workers are not qualified to pull up the weeds because they would inevitably pull up the wheat as well. So that just seems significant. That's always seemed significant to me as I think about what that might say to us and what our work to do in the world may be. Have you ever mistaken wheat for weeds? It really is easy to do sometimes. We we can look at people out of our own bias, our own prejudice. We can look at people out of our own experiences, and we can make an assessment, right? We have our own weed indicator, if you will, or our weed radar when we see folks. And maybe we look at people of a different race or a different nationality, or we look at people of a different political persuasion, or maybe we look at people of a different sexual orientation, or maybe people of a different religion, and we perhaps size them up and down because they are different from us, and we might be quick to identify them as weed-like. It may be that they just are wearing a different color uniform. It was the summer of my junior year as I was going into my senior year at high school, and I was working a summer job. My dad was the planning manager at Kloppman Mills, Burlington Industries in Denton, and he got me a summer job. And so I remember very well the very first day of my employment there that summer. One of the first people I saw was Bobby Hunt. When I saw Bobby and when Bobby saw me, we both had the same reaction. It was one of annoyance and dread. Bobby played for the Denton Red Raiders high school basketball team. I played for the Southwest Randolph Cougars basketball team. We were fierce rivals. We didn't like them. They didn't like us. On a brief aside, in what I've always kind of viewed as some divine humor, when I felt a call into pastoral ministry, the first place I was sent was to serve four churches in Denton. And I remember years later, the very first time I went into the Denton gym as now the new pastor in the Denton community, I remember when I walked in thinking the last time I had been in that gym was back in my high school days at the end of a basketball game, and there was a bit of a scrum in which I was involved. That's a story for another day. Bobby Hunt. I saw Bobby. Bobby saw me. We didn't care for each other. We immediately might have, if we were using the biblical language, would have identified each other as weeds. He played for Denton. I played for Southwest. He was bad to me. I was bad to him. And so we didn't have anything to say, didn't have anything to do with each other. We, I think, probably pretty much avoided each other as much as we could. And eventually, though, there came that time when our jobs kind of threw us together there in the grading department at Burlington Industries, Kloppman Mills in Denton. And as we began to work together, one thing led to another, and we'd start having conversations. We'd talk a little bit about our basketball experience, a little bit about our schools, but then we would just start talking about different things. And before long, as we began to work with each other, we started liking each other, and we started becoming friends. Eventually, before that summer was out, we actually became really good friends. We would take our breaks together. We would spend a lot of time together. Bobby was going off to school at East Carolina. He was a year ahead of me, and so he was heading off to East Carolina. And we even started making plans about the possibility of me going to East Carolina, and we could room together as college roommates. We both would love that. I still remember the night when Kathy and I came home after a date. We had gone out and we came home to our home in Seagrove to see my mom and dad for a little bit. And I remember my dad meeting me in the living room and telling me that Bobby Hunt had just been killed in a car accident. I still remember that feeling. I still remember weeping uncontrollably for several minutes in the darkened kitchen of our home. It's amazing, as I think back on that, how much you can grieve the loss of someone who you were absolutely sure at one point was a weed. Have you ever mistaken weed for wheat or wheat for weeds? It's really easy to do. We are a product of our own experience. We're a product of our own schools. We're a product of our own upbringing. We're a product of our own society. We're a product of our own faith traditions, our political persuasions. We are all infected with some degree of bias. It's unavoidable. We see the world through a particular lens because of a variety of things. No one is without bias. It's important to know that, I think, because if we're not careful, if we don't understand that we all have bias, if we don't understand that we all look through life and look at others and look at situations through our own individual lens that's been shaped by a variety of things, if we don't understand that about ourselves, if we begin to think that everything that we think and all of our opinions and the opinions of the people who are in our own personal thought bubble are the right opinions and everybody else is wrong and so they need to be discounted or discarded or demeaned, it can become quite destructive and dangerous. And taken to its extreme, if we're not aware of our own tendency to be biased in our judgments, if we don't have any degree of self-awareness in that regard, if we don't have any level of self-critique taken to its extreme, we can even allow ourselves to justify dehumanizing other people. I think that's maybe one of the greatest ills that has been a blight against God's good creation, the capacity for humans to dehumanize other humans. Have you ever found yourself mixing up weeds and wheats, thinking that you were looking at weeds, but maybe it was actually wheat you would learn later? Maybe it's a person or a group of people. Have you ever found yourself identified as a weed yourself? I remember years ago when I was working in radio, a caller, a radio listener, became so incensed with me that she took it upon herself to start a campaign to get me fired from my radio job. She called my boss. She was getting in touch with other people. It was important for her that Randy Lucas would be fired from WKXR Radio in Asheboro. And her reasoning was that she had told my general manager, my boss, Ed, that I had been rude to her on the air and on the telephone after we had talked off the air. The problem with that was the offending incident, when it occurred, I wasn't even at the radio station. It wasn't even me she was talking about. She thought it was me she was talking about. She actually had an encounter, a confrontation with our program director. And she had confused our voices, and so when she heard his voice, she thought it was me, and so she had determined that I was the weed in that scenario. Now, we all had a big laugh about it at the radio station when my boss told me about it, and we all kind of compared notes, and we all just laughed. But it was a good reminder to me that sometimes, you know, just getting out of bed in the morning, you can get yourself in trouble, even if you're not doing anything. It's interesting how we all have maybe sort of a weed detector, but as sure as we might be about identifying weeds in other people, perhaps we could rest assured that whatever list of weeds that we may have that we've made sort of internally, we can rest assured that our name perhaps is appearing on somebody's weed list somewhere. It's really important, I think, for us to remember as we think about this parable. One of the things that some commentators reflect on is how this parable can say something very important to us in the church. A reminder that evil will not forever have its sway. A recognition that one day God will bring evil to an end. Now, that doesn't mean that we as the church don't stand against evil and injustice and oppression in all of its forms. That's at the heart of our baptismal vows. We absolutely stand against that. Where we begin to veer off course is when we begin to personify evil in individuals or in groups of people, and we identify them as the weeds. One thing this parable teaches me is that I'm not qualified to be a collector of the weeds. I'm not qualified to be one who bundles and burns. And so the commentators invite us to look at this in the life of the church. That maybe one of the reasons why Matthew gives us this parable, the only, again, gospel writer who gives us this parable, is a word to the early followers of Jesus, to the early church, perhaps the next generation of Christian believers, the recognition that even in the life of the church, there are challenges. Even in the life of the church, where good seed has been sown, the evil one's presence is made known, sowing bad seed, sowing seeds of discord. Maybe it is a reminder and encouragement to the life of the church, not only in the early church, but the church throughout its ages, that God will ultimately bring evil to an end. And in the meantime, we recognize that ministry is messy. And even in the body of Christ, even within the community of faith, even in the church across the ages, there will always be wheat and weeds. This morning, as I think about this text, I think about, again, our propensity for perhaps being too quick to judgment in identifying weeds against the wheat, and recognizing that we ourselves can be identified as weeds for other people. I'm reminded of the reality that we can do everything that we believe God is calling us to do. We can be fully committed to living out our life of faith in Christ, denying ourselves daily, taking up our cross, and following Jesus. We can do everything that we think is the right thing to do and still find ourselves numbered among the weeds for some people. We shouldn't be surprised at that, of course. Jesus himself was accused of being in league with the devil. When a demoniac who was mute was brought to Jesus, and back in the 9th chapter of Matthew, and when the demon had been cast out, the one who had been mute spoke, and the crowds were amazed, and everybody was saying, "Never has anything like this been seen in Israel." But the Pharisees said, "By the ruler of the demons, he cast out demons." Jesus himself was to be seen as in league with the devils. And then Jesus, in giving the missional discourse to his disciples, sending them forward and telling them about how challenging it's going to be a little later in the Gospel of Matthew, reminds them that they're going to get the same treatment. A disciple, Jesus said, is not above the teacher, nor the slave above the master. It is enough for the disciples to be like the teacher and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? It shouldn't surprise us, of course, I guess, when we find ourselves sometimes identified as weeds in the field. There's a television show that you might find it interesting that has been somewhat of interest to me. Actually, I got interested in The Walking Dead with Kathy's help. Kathy invited me to watch The Walking Dead a few seasons ago, and I got interested in it. And one of the things about The Walking Dead that is fascinating is that the zombies in The Walking Dead, it's this apocalyptic zombies television show. Those of you who've seen it, you know what I'm talking about. But the real monsters are the people and the way people treat one another. And that's a big part of the storyline. And it is interesting that sometimes in the storyline we are not really sure who the good guys and the bad guys are. We know the good guys that we've pulled for from the very beginning of the show. And then they run across dealing with people of all kinds. A few seasons ago, they ran into a really, really bad guy. His name was Negan, played by Jeffrey Dean Morgan. And I liked that actor, and I thought he played the role so good, so I was fascinated in the Negan character. But he was a terrible character, a wonderful villain. He did some horrible things to the good guys, and so we were supposed to hate him in the context of the show. It was interesting. What's been interesting to me has been watching the sort of the redemption of Negan, and that's been kind of gradually happening, which I think is just a good part of the storyline. But at one point in the recent season, when Negan was having a conversation with Michonne, one of the good guys in the show, she was talking about all the terrible things that he had done, all the evil that he had perpetrated on the good guys. And Negan just said a line that I've always thought was a great line. He said, "No one ever believes they're the evil ones." I can't help but think sometimes, even as we think about identifying weeds and wheat and how we can sometimes get it wrong and sometimes people can get it wrong about us, I can't help but also think about the reality that maybe one way to think about this particular parable is how the seeds of both wheat and weeds are sown within us, that we can have the propensity for light and we can have the propensity for darkness. A number of years ago, I served a church, and Kathy and I got very close to an elderly couple. We went out to eat a lot. Good folks, salt of the earth. We just became fast friends. We would go out to eat, and even after I was no longer serving that church and I had moved on, they would occasionally give us a call, and we would meet and go out and eat. And they were everything that you could want as a pastor. They were encouraging and affirming. I never preached a bad sermon as far as they were concerned. They always had a kind word. And we just had a really nice friendship. And they were a very positive force in the life of the church. After I left, the next pastor, we had different personalities, and they didn't connect too well with the next pastor. And over time, that not connecting turned into something much more dark. They began to be very angry, and everything that pastor did was wrong in their mind. That pastor could do the exact same thing that I had done, but they saw me in a positive light. They saw him in a negative light. And I had many conversations with that couple and even with the former pastor, and we all tried to bring some reconciliation to it, but there had become such hatred and anger. And I saw this couple that had been such a force for good in the life of the church become a force that was destructive in the life of the church. It was a painful thing to see. Anger and hatred can do terrible things to the soul and the mind, and it can cloud your judgment in so many ways. But I learned something through that experience. What I learned was that we all of us, me and you, we all have the capability to do very good things, and we all have capability to do very bad things. I think it's important, even as we try to confront our own biases, that we try not to be controlled by our biases, that we acknowledge our biases and confess and repent and try to do those things that align us more fully with God's purposes in the world. When we acknowledge that, in addition, we need to acknowledge that not only do we have the seeds of wheat within us, but we have the seeds of weeds. And we all can give into the darkness. And we all can do the work of the devil in the world, as well as doing the work of God. So maybe as we think about this parable today, it's just a good reminder for us, number one, that there is work that we are not called to do. Now, the good news in this crazy 2020, when we've got so much on our mind, maybe it's really good news to know that this is work that God has taken off our plate. We are not charged with the work of identifying, bundling, and burning. That is left for the angels at the end of the age. So that's good news. And it's good for us to remember that even as we may jump to conclusions on who are the weeds and who are the wheat, maybe others are jumping to those conclusions about us. And maybe it's good to remember as we check our biases to acknowledge that we have some seeds within us that need to be dispelled. But I do bring you good news today. I bring you really good news. Even though there have been seeds of weeds planted by the evil one in all of us, there have been seeds of goodness. There have been seeds of light. And we do have the capability to make a difference in this world. God has enabled us with the seeds that allow us to bring to the world goodness and grace and mercy and love and justice, and forgiveness, and understanding. We can be vehicles of God's goodness and light in the world. Now, if you are determined to do some weeding, maybe God will give us the wisdom and discernment to do the weeding necessary in our own garden. And we can trust the garden of the world to the capable hands of the master gardener. My hope and my prayer for you and for me is that we will hear the voice of the Lord in all of our work, that we will know that in all of our dealings, in every conversation that we have, that every interaction that we have, in every joke that we tell, in everything that we do, every deed, we have the opportunity to be behaving in wheat-like ways or weed-like ways. My hope and my prayer is that God will give us grace and wisdom to do the work of the Lord, not the work of the evil one, so that at the end of the age, we'll be sure that we're not the ones being gathered up, bundled, and burned, but we will be the children of light, the children of righteousness, justice, mercy, compassion, and goodness to the glory of God. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is Gather Us In. I invite you to join us as we sing.
We're going to play this all the way through, if I can get my stand up. One time, because this is a less familiar hymn, but this is very good, and it follows right on to what Randy has just preached to us.
May we join together now for our closing prayer by bowing our heads together. Son of Man, we come before you on this holy day, united as one church body. We are listening, Lord. We are following in faith and repentance the call that you have on our lives in your kingdom here on earth. We turn our hearts over to you. We ask for your guidance and for your will to be shown to all of us during this sacred day, in this sacred moment. Yes, Lord, your servants are listening. And as we turn to you, we ask that you come more fully into our very beings, into our sacred temples, each one of us united together to serve your holy purpose. And we ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now let's turn together and let's fly away.
Thank you for joining us for our virtual worship today. We have been honored to have your presence with us. Would you look to me now and receive this benediction? Go forth in peace. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace.